video, we'll be demonstrating RabbitMQ, specifically how to set up and use it in a Kubernetes environment. So, RabbitMQ is a message queuing system, and it has open source code which you can find on GitHub. If we look at the RabbitMQ pinned repositories, we see that the standard way to install RabbitMQ on Kubernetes is with this cluster operator. We're going to be using this operator-based installation method. Moreover, we aim to show you the Kubernetes concepts behind this software. If you want to read more about the project, you can check out its homepage at rabbitmq.com and study its documentation, but we'll walk you through all the essential details. For this demo, we're using Google Kubernetes Engine. However, the concepts are applicable to different Kubernetes environments. Once our cluster is operational, our goal for setup will be primarily following the GitHub guidance on installation, which usually involves applying a kubectl file. It seems to be the same case here as we have an operator.yaml and a deployment file. While the RabbitMQ team is pretty trustworthy, it's not a bad idea to try and understand what you're installing before you proceed, especially in sensitive production environments. It looks like we have quite a lot of resources bundled into that operator. We have a deployment, a cluster role binding, a role binding, a cluster role, and several other resources. Many of these are related to RBAC, role-based access control, enabling the operator to create the resources it needs when we instantiate a RabbitMQ server. Essentially, we have this service account here that leverages these role bindings through various RBAC permissions. Most of the RBAC configuration seems to feed into this deployment. Then we use the custom resource definition, powered by that operator deployment, to create new RabbitMQ clusters. The namespace here is essentially compartmentalizing everything. Although some resources, such as the cluster roles and cluster role bindings, are non-namespaced, this overall configuration forms the basis of our RabbitMQ operator. We could dive deeper into the YAML itself, but it's extensive, covering about 5,500 lines of code, which can be cumbersome to manually review. We'll authenticate with the cluster first and then apply our cluster operator. An important aspect to keep an eye on is the resources required by this operator. We want to ensure that our cluster configuration with the node pools can support the required resources. The resources we're requesting here constitute about a fifth of a CPU core and around half a gigabit of memory. Next, we can proceed with the creation of a RabbitMQ cluster. This step involves a significantly smaller YAML file. It essentially only creates a custom resource definition. However, based on the installed operator, several other resources will be created when we apply this code. It might feel like a bit of a wait for the pod to power up, but as soon as we see that it's 1 out of 1 ready, we know we're moving forward. Now let's dive into the logs and ensure everything is running as expected. Everything seems to be running smoothly, so we can proceed with establishing a connection to this new instance. We're going to create a new Python pod for this mission. The command here could seem long, but it's really just orchestrating the creation of a brand new pod that contains Python 3.11, and then it'll sit around doing nothing. Post this pod creation, we should be primed to exec into it and use it as our gateway to the new RabbitMQ instance. Interacting with our new pod requires a Python library. Lucky for us, we have root access on this container, meaning we can simply do a pip install of pyka. To illustrate using the new connection, we'll use an interactive Python interpreter. Our newly created user will be key to this step. Let's safely tuck away the username and password from the associated Kubernetes secret. Time to call on the Python interpreter once more. Let's see if we can establish a connection. After we've checked that our service is running on the expected port, 5672, let's create a queue that we can use for publishing and subscribing to messages. Ready to start consuming messages on the channel? And voila, behold our Hello World message. Now let's review this concept from a bird's eye perspective. Imagine that we're in possession of an API which gobbles up images from users. We yearn for the ability to announce when these images have been stored, likely after a little pre-processing, in our cloud storage system. We might have a legion of worker deployments running ML on these images. By enlisting RabbitMQ as our intermediary, we create a bridge freeing us from the confines of a synchronous dependency. For instance, it would be wholly unrealistic to expect a user to wait for an API call to conclude before their next step, with the clock ticking and the HTTP response expected. This pattern enables users to submit via the API and wait for their response once the whole process is done and dusted. This separation of concerns using message queues can provide to be a huge efficiency win and improve scalability and reliability. We hope this walkthrough was enlightening. You can find the diagram file and the Python code in the video description. Got any burning questions? Fire away in the comment section. And as always, please enjoy responsibly.